Okay, thanks for the kind introduction. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Khalil Amin and the organizing committee for inviting me to participate in this interesting conference. The title of my talk today is Progress on Sodium Ion Batteries, Research and Commercial Overlaps. After a short introduction, I am going to speak about retrospectives and advances in anodes, cathodes, electrolytes, and industrial developments to finish my presentation with summary and conclusions. Sodium ion battery is a nascent technology. There are currently significant developments, rapid advances, and discoveries. There is already commercialization of first generation systems. Regarding the publication and patents, an exponential increase appears in the last 10 years. There are some advantages and disadvantages. Basically, electrochemical performance, low gravimetric and volumetric energy, difficulty in achieving broader voltage window, and difficulties with utilizing graphite. Regarding the technological evolution of sodium-ion batteries, in the 1970s, sodium metal oxides cathodes were analyzed. In the 1980s, high-temperature sodium batteries were developed with applications in electrical mobility and grid storage. In the 1990s, development of zebra cells with applications in grid storage. From 2000 to 2010, the research was focused basically on lithium-ion batteries. But the discovery of hard carbon as sodium in sodium-ion batteries were developed in this spot. And finally, in the last 10 years, a revival of sodium-ion battery research with application in first startups, in mobility, and grid storage. Regarding anodes, regarding the anode materials, we can divide it into two groups. With energy density of approximately 250 watts hour kilogram, organic electrodes and oxide materials, and with energy density higher than 300 watts hour kilogram alloys and carbons. There are different families of anodes, carbon derivatives, titanates, alloys, poly-C bases, carbodiimides, organic materials in general. Considering those families with high energy density, alloys exhibit some drawbacks like high volumetric exchange, irreversibility, low first cycle Coulombic efficiency, and electrolyte degradation. So, considering the advantages of carbon derivatives, we are focused on presentation in the commercialization of materials. So, we are analyzing briefly the carbon derivatives. Regarding the capacity versus average voltage, we can see that a high average voltage, the graphene derivatives exhibit a higher energy density. On the contrary, a low average voltage, hard carbon, with like cycle, exhibit a higher capacity. It's worth mentioning the hard carbon prepared by Professor Komawa with 580 milliamperes per gram. The big drawback of these materials is the poor phase cycle Coulombic efficiency. In the case of some carbons, they exhibit energy densities similar to the best graphenes. There are some strategies for improved performance. One of them is the precise control of conditions, the synthesis conditions, and the choice of precursors, organic, polymeric, and biomass, in order to get soft carbon or hard carbon. Also, the precise control of product, the structure, particle size, morphology, and also we can improve the capacity by tailoring some phosphorus and sulfur doping materials. Regarding cathodes, there are five families that we can classify as sodium ion oxide, polyanionic materials, Prussian blue analogous, conversion methods, cathodes, and organic cathodes. The best materials for commercialization are the sodium ion oxide, polyanionic materials, and Prussian blue that we are discussed briefly. In cathodes, we are going to start with the sodium ion oxides. The sodium ion oxides have different structural classification, the most important are P2 and O3 types. In the case of three types, they have fully sodiated phase, sodium content, high sodium content, one sodium crystallographic independent, and the average oxidation state for transition metal is 3. For example, in the case of the manganese, manganese 3, with a Jantelier effect, giving rise to multiple steep cycling performance. On the contrary, in the case of P2, the average oxidation state for transition metal is 3 and 4, and the manganese 4 is not Jantelier active, so these materials exhibit good structural stability with high diffusion coefficient and 2 sodium crystallographically independent. The main drawback is the low sodium content in these materials that can be overcome by using sacrificial salts. Also, it's important in this case the use of doping to control the effect on the stability of host structure. We have analyzed the manganese 80% and iron 20% with some substitution of the titanium 10% and 20%. If we analyze the electrochemical behavior of this system, we can see that in the manganese iron without titanium, we have very good capacity, but moderate stability. In the case of 10% of titanium, we have good capacity retention. And for 20% of titanium, we have low capacity values, but excellent stability. So the percentage of the substitution is really important. So we can analyze some strategies to follow the best electrochemical behavior for all materials, that this electrochemical performance depends on multiple parameters. The P2 phases offers good performance and smooth log curves. It's important to have high manganese content with manganese oxidation state 4 in order to avoid the Jantelier effect, with small substitution of, for example, doping with inactive metals that we can improve the stability. With copper, we can improve the energy density. In nickel, the average voltage, and the zinc, we can improve the performance. So, with a small doping substitution of carefully selected element for optimizing the stoichiometries, we can improve significantly the electrochemical behavior of these layer oxides. One important point is the anionic redox reaction that can give rise in some cases in discussion, because there are some alkali-rich transition metal oxides that exhibit anomalous excess capacity. For example, the P2 type sodium magnesium manganese oxide was prepared at Comava. They exhibit a large capacity of 220 milliamperes per gram, not explained by manganese 3, manganese 4 redox reaction. This was explained 5 years later by Professor Blu, saying that a reversible OCM redox process. Professor Rond also prepared the P2 type sodium lithium manganese oxide, and with a decrease in the capacity of about 200 milliamperes per gram when reducing voltage window. In the first charge, it's attributed to the anionic redox reaction because there is no reaction because manganese is inactive. In the case of this charge, both anionic redox reaction and manganese 4 manganese 3 redox activity appear. Recently, Professor Bruce's group prepared these two family of materials, sodium, lithium, manganese, with a small difference in the amount of lithium and manganese in both cases, but the structure is completely different. In one case, we have Honeycomb superstructure, and the other one, Raybon superstructure. In the Honeycomb superstructure, there is a formation of molecular oxygen with migration and transition metal layers, the manganese cations. In the case of the Raybon superstructure, neither oxygen formation of manganese migration occurs. This electrochemical behavior was explained with Professor Bruce for the presence of anionic redox reaction. However, this interpretation is a radical departure from a materials chemistry point of view. So there is some significant controversy regarding this interpretation. This way, Professor van der Velde published recently an article related to lithium-rich manganese-positive materials, and he found different manganese oxidation process from manganese 4 to manganese 7, migration of this cation from octahedral to tetrahedral sites, formation of peroxide ions trapped to molecular oxygen, and formation of manganese 7 followed by spontaneous dimerization oxygen and the composition of cation material. So, a detailed experimental study should be carried out in these systems in order to shed further light on this topic, on this interesting topic. Other family of cathodes is the polyanionic cathodes. It's a great range of choices. They exhibit higher redox potential than oxide. They are robust framework. They have robust framework and high thermal stability and safety. There are some limitations, for example, in the case sodium pyrophosphate with low operative voltage and the sodium ion sulfate with strongly hygroscopic character. The best materials for polyanionic cathodes are the fluorophosphate and phosphate. The fluorophosphate exhibit a specific capacity higher, quite similar, near similar to the theoretical one, with two plateaus, a 3.3 voltage plateaus, a 3.6 and 4.1 volts, with high energy density and excellent cyclability. But if we modified the synthesis of this material, for example, using sorbothermal route, that no further carbon quoting is needed, we can arrive to get good excellent capacity, quite similar to the theoretical one, and a low C rate, and also a high C rate, a 2C, for example, 100 milliamperes per gram, with 80% of capacity retention after 1,200 cycles. Also, the NASICO, sodium vanadium phosphate, this material operates at 3.4 and 1.5 volts, can be acted as anode and cathode in asymmetrical cells. The experimental capacity is quite similar to the theoretical one, but also a high C rate. They have good capacity and extraordinary cycle life up to 10,000 cycles and 100 C. The Prussian blue analogous, these materials exhibit a wide range of operation voltages, high reversible capacities, high energy densities, low temperature of synthesis, with some drawbacks like high amounts of conductivity, carbon is needed, low volumetric capacity, and also low Coulombic efficiency. These materials for Prussian blue are those related to the iron and manganese. The iron with good reversible capacity and excellent cyclability, and manganese with good reversible capacity, excellent reversible capacity and good cyclability. So this manganese and iron, Prussian blue, are excellent compounds for electrochemical behavior, considering that the manganese and iron are cheap and not toxic. An overview of the cathode materials is represented here in the figure. We can see layer of sites, green color, present highest theoretical specific capacities. The polyanionic materials, red colors, exhibit experimental capacities very close to the theoretical values. And the blue, the Prussian blue analogous in the blue color, they have greater variability and theoretical experimental specific capacity values. In the case of the electrolytes require some conditions, for example, electrochemical, good electrochemical and thermal stability, good transport properties, compatibility, and low toxicity and cost. The most important electro systems are aqueous liquid electrolytes, non-aqueous liquid electrolytes, organic and ionic, solid state electrolytes, solid polymer electrolytes, inorganic solid electrolytes, and composite. We represent here the conductivity, the ionic conductivity of the most important materials in electrolyte materials. Sodium. Sodium electrolytes exhibit less toxic, are less toxic and safer than the analogous of lithium. We are going to analyze briefly the liquid electrolytes. In the liquid electrolytes, we have carbonate ester base electrolytes. They have created a protective cell. The use of additives such as fluoroethylene carbonate favors the formation of very thin films that protect the negative electrons. In the case of ether-based electrolytes, allow the sodium solvent co-intercalation in graphite electrodes, building stable cells. These materials, the SEI in ether-based electrolytes, are more compact, highly stable, and thinner than the carbonate ester-based electrolytes, which can significantly decrease the diffusion length on sodium ions and prevent the extra decomposition of the electrolyte. We have analyzed also the effect of the electrolyte. Comparing the organic electrolyte with ionic liquid. We have used the sodium manganese iron titanium 10% using as organic electrolyte is the blue color and the ionic liquid the green color. We can see here that at low C rates, the specific capacity of the organic electrolyte is higher than in the case of the ionic liquid. But the capacity retention, on the contrary, is better in the case of the ionic liquid than in the organic electrolyte. At high C rates, both in the specific capacity and the capacity retention are higher than in the organic electrolytes. So we can conclude that the ionic liquid electrolytes can be postulated as next generation of sodium-based electrolytes. But considering that the cost and ionic conductivity at low temperature should be improved. Regarding solid electrolytes avoid or diminish the safety problems. They have high thermal stability, wide electrochemical stability window, excellent mechanical properties, but the main drawback is the low ionic conductivity at room temperature. Solid electrolytes, we can classify in inorganic solid electrolytes, oxide, phosphate, sulfides, and hydride. They are hard and inflexible. Solid polymer electrolytes, they are suboptimal performance, and the composite and hybrid systems in order to improve the physical and electrochemical properties. There are not many publications related with all solid state batteries. Professor Hu, some years ago, published a study using the Nacicon as solid electrolyte and the sodium vanadium phosphate as cathode. Working at 80 degrees C, they found good reversible capacity in the first cycle, but there is a degradation in the capacity after fourth, fourth, 40 cycles. They put a small amount of liquid electrolyte and working at room temperature, they found good capacity in the first, in the reversible phase cycle, but the degradation now starts at 250 cycles. When they used a small amount of ionic liquid, they found good capacity in the in a low C rate and also at room temperature, and also good capacity at high C rate, 10C at room temperature, 90 milliamperes per gram, with an excellent capacity retention after 10,000 cycles. So the ionic liquid can effectively enhance the interface contact between solid-solid particles. An overview of the electrolytes. They exhibit highest ionic conductivities at room temperature. Both the liquid, the aqueous liquid electrolytes, and the non-aqueous liquid electrolytes. However, the aqueous liquid electrolytes have an important drawback due to the low electrochemical stability window. The non-aqueous liquid electrolytes have problems related to the SCI stabilization and flammability. In order to overcome these drawbacks, we can design some functional solid state electrolytes as those described in the figure. Being the main pros and cons of these materials, which are described on the basis of six important criteria for electrochemical energy storage devices, from economic to physico-chemical and electrochemical properties. For future perspectives in materials for NIPS, we have the anode in hard carbon. We need to improve the first cycle Coulombic efficiency to control the microstructure porosity and to increase the number of studies related to the electrode-electrolyte interface. Regarding cathode, for example, the manganese-based layer oxide, we have to control the doping or substitution, to analyze some new stoichiometries, to follow the manganese evolution and the different oxidation state in the redox process, and to analyze in detail the anionic redox process of these materials. In the case of phosphate and fluorophosphates, we have to replace the vanadium, because it's toxic and expensive, by another metal. In the case of Prussian blue, considering that the manganese and iron Prussian blue compounds exhibit the best electrochemical behavior, a solid solution of these manganese iron compounds should be developed and studied also in detail. Regarding the electrolyte, is the key in the sodium ion batteries at the moment, because many people are working in anode and cathode, but not many people in electrolyte. It's important to design new electrolytes, solving compatibility of the novel source, safety, cost, and also to analyze the electrode-electrolyte interfaces, to develop some calculation and experimental work, and important, enable solid-state batteries. Also thinking for the full cells in reducing cost at material levels in order to improve the cost of the kilowatts hour per cycle. Industrial developments. The first generation of sodium ion batteries are already attracting commercial interest, both in non-aqueous and aqueous electrolytes. In the case of Nunaco's electrolytes, there are different companies, Feredion, Fresh Network with Tiamat, Haina in China, and Nova Suisse. All of them are working with hard carbon as anode. And in the case of Feredion and in Haina in China with layer oxides, Fresh Network with Tiamat in polyanionic materials, basically vanadium fluorophosphate, Nova Suisse with Prussian blue. You will observe, for example, the Feredion with layer oxide hard carbon this year. This device exhibits an energy density of about 160 watts hour kilogram, higher than those given in the lithium iron phosphate with graphite cells. And in the case of aqueous sodium ion matrix, Natron Energy is a spin-off from the University of Stanford, uses Prussian blue for both cathode and anode. The power values are approximately 800 watts hour per kilogram at round times of 30 seconds. The cells are able to run over 25,000 cycles at 12C with 70% of total capacity and 6% degradation over 6 months. Regarding the cost, a comparison of the estimated lithium ion batteries and sodium ion batteries cost has been developed for different authors following three different parameters. One of them is the comparison of relatively cost of lithium versus sodium precursors, and also considering the current collectors, copper and aluminium in lithium and sodium respectively. The second parameter, the composition cost of full cells of sodium and lithium ion batteries, considering lithium and sodium nickel manganese cobalt layer oxides, carbon-based as electrodes, as anode, and organic electrolytes. And the third parameter, using this layer oxides, but from our other perspective, including materials, processing, and environmental factors. So we can conclude that sodium ion batteries may offer lower cost than lithium ion batteries for certain applications. As summary and conclusions, the first generation of sodium ion batteries, in the case of anode, hard carbon is the best candidate for anode in sodium ion batteries. Layer oxides are polyanionics with organic electrolytes, and the Prussian blue with aqueous electrolytes. It's also important to exploit the key advantages tailored to applications. In the case of electrolyte, solid state batteries are the most suitable design for large scale energy storage. Electrolyte interface issues should be analyzed in deep. The market is, there is already prototypes from 0.1 to 100 kilowatts hour. Sodium ion approaching market price limits. So we have to tailor the first generation materials to move to the second generation materials. Sodium ion technology is well positioned as a future energy storage technology. So we can think in the next steps on sodium related batteries. This way, we have, for example, sodium sulfur at room temperature or sodium oxygen, as we can see in the Ragon plot, high energy density than the sodium ion batteries, but also nickel ion capacitors, also lithium ion capacitors. They have lower energy density than the nickel ion, the sodium ion batteries, but they have higher power than the sodium ion batteries. And in, also, in comparison with the supercapacitors, the double layer, they have lithium and sodium ion capacitors exhibit higher energy density and with similar power density. So we can conclude sodium ion batteries is in TRL. Sodium ion batteries, the TRL is approximately 6 or 7. On the contrary, in the room temperature of sodium sulfur, sodium ion capacitor and sodium oxygen, they are in TRL 1-3. So research progress in these topics is needed in the future. I would like to thank to the Spanish government and the Basque government for funding, and thank you for your kind attention.